Hey everyone, welcome to the Theater Podcast. This is a podcast about theater, and we have intimate, personal conversations with the industry's biggest names. This episode is 2 of 4 of the Back to the Future Takeover. The guests for this are real-life friends and onstage friends, Merritt David Janes and Jelani Ramey, who share their love for many, many things on this episode, including, the bowling league. We start out talking about the Broadway bowling league, among other things, but just how much they pump each other up on stage and how much the show means to them. So, if you haven't already, go back to a previous episode and catch the first episode of The Takeover with Nate Hackman. And then there's 2 more episodes coming up after this with Casey Likes and Liana Hunt. And, just go see Back to the Future because it freaking rocks. All right, find me online, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Threads, all the places. Leave a rating and a review, all the stuff. Gosh, I'm coming up on episode 300. I've said this so many times. You know what to do. All right, everybody, enjoy this episode with Merritt David Janes and Jelani Ramey. I'm excited to bring you an amazing duo for this episode. Both are no strangers to the Broadway stage. First, we welcome back returning podcast guest Jelani Ramey, who we last spoke to in episode 253, and whose credits include Ain't Too Proud, The Lion King, High School Musical 1 and 2, and Smokey Joe's Cafe, and was recognized as a Paper Mill Playhouse Rising Star, and is a Cheetah Rivera Award recipient. Our other guest is Merritt David Janes, who recently graced the Broadway stage in the original cast of School of Rock, and has performed in national tours of School of Rock, Sweeney Todd, Beauty and the Beast, The Wedding Singer, Phantom Shrek, and Catch Me If You Can, and was recently in the world premiere of Griswold's Broadway Vacation. Together, they have exactly 2 gazillion more credits, including Jelani now playing Mayor Goldie Wilson in Marvin Berry, and Merritt playing Principal Strickland, both in the Broadway production of, you guessed it, Back to the Future. Merritt, welcome, and Jelani, welcome back to the Theater Podcast.
Yes.
Hello.
I'm excited. There we go. That was exciting.
That was the best part of the day because it's rainy and nasty. So we were just talking before we got going about the bowling league. So I want to pick up there.
We are the Marty McStrikes. That's right. Every Thursday, we take over frames, and every Broadway show has a team, and we all bowl against each other.
Do they still do Broadway softball?
They do Broadway everything. Yes, they sure do in the spring.
Man, because it is a rainy, nasty day on this Friday morning we're recording, and flooding. The FDR is closed down. I got little 311 app popped up that said alternate side parking is suspended today and tomorrow because of flooding.
We love that, honey. The outdoor sports are canceled for today, okay?
Dude. Yeah. All right. So who's better bowler?
Oh, it depends.
Who's the best bowler on the... wait, you're not the pinheads? You should be the pinheads.
We are the pinheads.
Oh, it is the pinheads? I thought it was the Marty McStrikes. See, that's how much I know.
I'm going to go get the shirt. Should I go get the shirt?
Yeah, get the shirt. Yeah, show them the shirt. We got merch.
Who's the best on the Marty McPinheads? Who's the best bowler?
Honestly, Merritt's a good bowler. Nate Hackman's a good bowler. Jelani Ramey is a good bowler.
Hey, that's you.
Jelani Ramey is a good bowler.
Also, our dresser Dean is a good bowler.
I went bowling the other day, and I just started trying to do the curvy thing, so you could do the
curvature, Pacific curvature, I call it. Pacific curvature. I don't know what it's an art. There are people that are full out. They have their wrist guards. Yeah. They bring their own ball. They're really, really ready to bowl.
Check this out. This is the back.
You see?
It is the pinheads.
Oh, it is the pinheads. It's you know why? Because we voted. We had a vote on a name, and I think I voted for Marty McStrikes, but. Pinheads one. Do you have your name on it too?
Sure do. Everybody put their character's name, but I'm just Merritt. It's just me, Merritt.
You don't want to be just called Strickland?
Stevie Strix would be a good bowler.
You could just That's be true. The principal. The principal is very ominous.
Yeah, I should have put principal.
That strike sphere, get it? All right, so when you are not bowling and coming up with punny bowling names and whatnot, the two of you, I guess you're putting on the jersey.
I'm putting
now.
On my shirt.
Oh, Merritt's putting on his bowling shirt. So now we're ready.
Yeah, there we
now
go.
We're ready. Okay.
So I guess something that is as big of a show as Back to the Future that requires so much effort, and I feel like just so much production magic behind the scenes. And I will call it magic because I'm not allowed to know how the car works and other things and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So outside of the bowling and whatnot, do you guys all as a cast hang out a lot like this? Or is it just like you come to work and you leave and you don't talk to each other anymore? Like, especially well, for the two of you who have scenes together, right? Like, how does that work personally?
I think when you love what you do, it's not work at all. And we were having so much fun at the Winter Garden. I wish people can get an ounce of what goes on backstage and see like the foolery, the camaraderie, but also just the joy that we get to have putting the show together. And yes, we all bowl together on Thursdays because we love each other. You know what I mean? We hang out at the theater because we really enjoy each other. Or our group chat is really just tremendous and chock full of fun. We have a great time, and I think that translates to on stage. Merritt, you used to say wonderful things about our friendship.
Objection, Your Honor. Leading the witness. I think the same thing. There's a lot of differences in a lot of different shows that you can be a part of. It can be a great experience, but there's like maybe the schedule's not great, or on one show, or you really like the role and maybe the cast wasn't great, or I've been very lucky to be with good casts and stuff like that. But this is one of those great shows where it's all great. Every box is fantastically checked, and none more so than the group that we've got to start this thing off. And everybody in the show is I couldn't have hoped for a better cast, and I feel like every day I walk in, I'm like, this really is the one I was waiting for.
Aww. You know what it is? I think also everybody is so wonderfully specific and it's like a melting pot of individuals that are so like wonderful and so like unique. And we all sort of bounce off each other and respect each other and get to see each other shine in this show, especially Merritt, David, James, where we get to kiki in our diner. And
it's all business in there.
It's all business in the diner. But like, he sets me up for my song. He gives me the fuel I need to then go forth to George. But everybody is just so great at what they do. It's fun to see everybody shine, and it's powerful how we all shine together.
I guess, I mean, Merritt, your dad was a slacker, and you're a slacker too. I guess going through some, we'll take that quote into a very horrible segue into how the movie influenced your childhood, because and Jelani, too, think about your answer here as well. But like, thinking back to when you were a kid, was this story, this franchise, this movie, was it something that influenced you in any sort of way as a kid, as a performer?
This is my favorite movie of all time, I tell people.
So yes,
everybody at some point gets asked, "What's your favorite movie?" And that's a hard question to answer for most people, but it's not for me. Back to the Future. I could do all three movies for you right now. This like a pinch me moment around every corner for this one. And it did. I remember falling in love with Jennifer when I was like 8. I love the ways that this movie has inspired people. Like John Mayer talked about how he was inspired to play the guitar, pick up the guitar and learn it when he watched Marty McFly's guitar solo in 1955.
I did not know that.
Yeah,
me
it's
either.
Pretty cool. I'm hoping that gets us some kind of VIP seating at one of his concerts at some point.
Love that.
Well, John Mayer always writes me after every episode. He's definitely a listener. Yeah. Yeah. that's really cool. Jelani, did you have like similar experience with the IP, I guess, the franchise?
You know, I am much younger than Merritt, so I did not I was a late bloomer to the Back to the Future. My older siblings watched it, so I remember seeing it with them as they were babysitting me. But it was later on in life when I was doing like camp sleepovers, and it was the movie to watch. But I know one thing. When I knew that the show was coming to Broadway, I brushed up on my Shakespeare, and I relived it. And it was like, you could see why it's a timeless classic. You can see why it's stood the test of time and why so many people love this and why so many fans are loving the musical. And it's awesome to be a part of this.
We're going to talk about the phrase much younger later.
We can break it down now. We got time.
I forget. I want to know how much younger. I'm going to think about this. I'm going to guess later. Okay. I'll just yell it out when I know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I guess the character of Strickland in and of itself, Merritt, is like in the movie, it's so important, I think, to Marty's motivation of just like he's got all these people that are against him, all these things that are against him in the story and the world and whatnot, right? And so you're, I had a similar question for Nate Hackman too, the role of Biff, right? Like you're embodying this negativity, this bad guy that helps drive the story forward. So in getting cast in a role like this, where you have to really, be disliked. To be good, you have to be disliked. Is that a different approach when you're starting to create things versus like a Dewey for School of Rock?
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, this is such an iconic story that I think the circumstances of it just paint everything and lay every brick in the road along the way. But yeah, I think when you look at Biff and Strickland, they're obstacles in Marty's way, right? And, you know, we have to remember the iconic nature of the franchise while we're doing it, but also not forget ourselves and where we're at on the Broadway stage and bringing it into a little bit of a different life. So I don't think that we, I like the idea that people like Strickland and that he never changes. He's just right. Kind of this cranky old goat. I kind of wanted to paint some sort of accurate picture of how principals were back in 1955. And I don't know, we all had a couple teachers in high school that were there for like a long time. We're like, oh, this is how it was back in like the 70s. Right. And I think Strickland's like that. And the joke to me is that he just kind of doesn't change. Like you look at him in 1955, he's just the same exact person that he is in 1985. I think he's definitely an obstacle in Marty's way, and he doesn't really change. Biff changes, but Strickland doesn't change. He's just kind of cranky about everything, and especially when Marty's band is introduced at the end, he doesn't like that.
Merritt, you have touring credits out the wazoo. So just not talking about BTTF for a second. How much of your working actor time have you actually spent in New York? Because I want to flag for listeners that being a working actor in New York City usually means you're nowhere near New York City.
Well, I'm sitting here in my apartment that I've had the apartment for 18 years.
Whoa.
We just passed the 18 year mark. And I think I've lived in it for six. I've spent a lot of time on tour, and I enjoy it. You know, any job, I think, whether it's here or on tour, this is always like a baseball team that never goes out of season, you know. And I've been to every state except for two. North Dakota and Alaska, and I think I better go to North Dakota first because it'd be really weird to just end the whole adventure in Fargo. it's all just been this big adventure that's led me back here. I probably would have chosen to get back here a little earlier, but my goal when I left left theater school was to play great parts in great theaters, and I've been able to do that. And this show is like a culmination of a lot of years of just kind of getting what I call campaign syndrome. You know, when you see a politician and they're like, thank you, Boston. And they're like, we're in Chicago. you kind of like forget where you are sometimes. But it's been a lot of years of that, of just kind of, if a tornado was really fun, that's how I picture it. Like if Dorothy never left the tornado and it was really fun, that's what touring is. And it's the house has kind of landed here in New York City, and I'm so glad it's with this show. This is a great one to be back with. And I jokingly say that the Winter Garden Theater is the only building they'll let me work in New York, because that's where I worked with School of Rock, and I'm so happy to be back there. We've got the best staff there, best crew, and now the best company with Back to the Future.
That's so cool. And you said when you left theater school, which is University of Maine, yes?
University of Maine, I went to music school, and then I made the practical decision to go to theater school. and that was here at Circle in the Square Theater, which I lovingly refer to as the Hogwarts School of Theater. And I left there and just immediately started touring with The Wedding Singer. And that is how this is all coming full circle, really, because I started as Robbie Hart with The Wedding Singer in 2000. And did you have a problem with the connection there?
No.
that was with John Rando and Chris Bailey. And Chris Bailey's wife, Sarah O'Gleavy, who's very much conquering the Broadway scene along with Chris these days. And we just had a blast. And when this came along, I walked in and just saw their familiar, friendly faces. And here we are.
We're going to be right back. But you're from Colchester, Vermont.
That's right.
Yes. Yeah. What got you into wanting to perform, sing? I guess undergrad with music was first. So I guess you were a musician first or a singer, performer? How did that all come about?
Well, my mom was the concertmaster of the Vermont Philharmonic. So I had music in my life, my whole life.
Gelati's nodding his head like he had no idea. I don't think you guys are as good of friends as you thought.
I did not know that.
I mean, you guys got you got some catching up to do.
That's not something I lead with. Hey, nice to meet you.
I would. My mom's the concert master, okay?
Yeah.
My mother,
hey,
the
nice
concert
to meet
master.
You. My mom's a concert master, okay?
I would have loved it. I would have loved it.
That's how I started with a lot of music in my life. My grandfather, he was awesome. He was such a talented guy, funny guy, great storyteller. And he was a lawyer, but he played jazz piano. And he would play with the big bands when they would pass through town. And like the Count Basie Orchestra and those guys. But they'd pass through Connecticut, and he'd sit in sometimes when they'd come through.
Is there a musical about, like, that features lawyers? You know, I'm just picturing him pulling in a piano, giving his closing arguments to a big jazz band performance.
Yeah.
I love that.
I like the idea of a cease and desist letter going out that stops that musical.
Fair. Very fair point. And then, let's see, Jelani, you're from New Jersey. And let's see.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, you went to Montclair State, New Jersey, and then remind us again you obviously gave the full story back in EP 253, but what was your road to Broadway as well?
Yeah, so like Mayor, after I got a job from school, I started doing High School Musical, and I was 19 going on tour, and I did that tour for like almost 2 years, and I've been to every state but Alaska.
Whoa, you even North
Which
Dakota
kind
now?
Of exciting.
Jelani.
Even North Dakota, because after High School Musical, I did High School Musical 2 after that. And then I did The Lion King in Las Vegas.
Right.
And then I did The Lion King on tour I toured for about 4 years on the road with Lion King. So we've been traveling, we've been going. And then that took me to Broadway. They transferred me from the tour to Broadway. And I've been sort of running around here in the concrete jungle.
Wow.
Do we need to take a trip to Alaska?
I think we do. We should take a cruise.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Alaska.
And we bring the concert master.
That's right. The concert master will enjoy herself very much.
Listen.
I love it.
At the end of August, I just did an Alaska cruise. So I can say now.
You did?
Yes, I did. And
What was your favorite thing you saw?
just freaking nature, man. That is just
right.
Untouched territory, because all the cities up there, you can't drive to them from the mainland. You have to get to them from by boat or by plane, or you know, your ferry takes the car over. So Anchorage, Juneau, we docked in, let's see, we ported in Ketchikan, Juneau, and I'm blanking on the third one, but all of the cities were completely like isolated in terms of roads. You just it's insane.
Merit.
You got to do it.
We want to be where the salmon are.
Oh yeah, that's we saw right. salmon and wild bears. Saw some wild bears. It was great. No, it was awesome. Highly recommend. Definitely do it. And also, if you can pitch yourselves, you can put together a variety act, because on the ships, they hire all these variety acts that go out with the ships. So
yeah,
there you go. There you go. So that's what you got to do. I'm giving this. You can take this idea for free. Put together your little.
This has literally been a think tank. We thought about new musicals. We're thinking about cruises. I love this.
We're going to do the lawyer musical on the Alaska
on the cruise.
Okay, Simba grows up, becomes a lawyer.
Yeah,
travels back in time, meets the principal that got him off of Pride Rock in the first place. See where I'm going? Like, we can weave it all together.
I love this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then we hire children to play the music.
Yes.
School of Rock.
What would the... Yeah, great idea. What would the time travel mode be for a time traveling lawyer Simba?
It'd have to be something with Rafiki. You know what I mean? So you'd have to do some sort of spell or something. We take a cheetah back. We take the cheetah. The cheetah runs 88 miles.
The cheetah must reach 88 miles per hour.
Exactly.
I like that.
That's right.
I'm going to pitch it.
All right. I think Disney... hold on. Disney's calling. Oh, no. Yep. $2 million.
And there's the cease and desist.
There we go. Cease and desist coming through. But it was a musical, so there we go. Okay. So just real quick, too, when did both of you guys get involved with this production of Back to the Future? Like, was it... I was
pretty late to the game.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was pretty late to the game. I auditioned with other people have already auditioned, so I was in, like, the final round, I think. And I auditioned on, like, a random Thursday or something, and they had me come back Friday to dance. And then came back Saturday to sing some more, because I wasn't available. I sort of kept putting it off for a while. But then once I got the material, and I was like, whoa, this is something you really sink your teeth into. This is something wonderful. And then I got to go into a room with eight other guys that look just like me, and we're all sort of doing our thing, dancing. And I love the choreography. I fell in love with the choreography. I had just worked with Chris Bailey on another project for Hermes that he choreographed. So we had a sort of rapport, and I walk into my callback, and there's Chris Bailey. There's John Rando, who I idolize. And there's our producers, who I worked with on Smokey Joe's off Broadway. So it was sort of like all the worlds colliding. And so it sort of felt like a family reunion in a way. So the pressure was sort of off, and I felt like... Like, I still feel like the best auditions are the ones where you can be yourself and your nerves are not on, and you're not like, hey, don't you want to cast me? The best are when you can sort of leave there saying, I was able to exhale. And that was a moment that I felt like I was able to exhale and be myself. And I felt good about it no matter what happened. So I let it go, and I didn't hear anything for about 2.5 months.
Whoa,
really?
So I let it go. I was okay with it. I was like, you know what? You had a good time? Not your gig? That's okay. You had a good time. And they called me when I was at my high school in Cedar Grove. I was helping them with their production of The Prom. And I got a phone call from my agent, and I was with my choir teacher that is the reason why I'm a performer now. You know, she sort of got me my start by casting me as Duty in Grease. And I got to tell her that I was about to originate my first role on Broadway.
That's so cool. Merritt, how did you get involved? Were you involved from the New York?
That's
run
a great story.
Before?
I was out in, we were just coming back from the beginning of me coming back into the world of theater after the pandemic was really in 2020, early 2021.
Yeah.
Excuse me, 22. I went down and did Buddy Holly down in Florida. That was kind of the first thing back. And then after that, they called me to come do the Griswold's Broadway Vacation, which was out west in Seattle. And I had just left that, and I was just getting back to the East Coast, and we just kind of, it just kind of seamlessly was there for the appointment when I got back, and it just kind of happened so quickly that it was hard for me to wrap my brain around, but it was really a big relief because, you know, all of us, we had worked for so long, and then to have this be on the radar, just the first year back, I was very thankful for that, and I was hopeful that it would work out. And then, like Jelani said, you know, I went into the room, and we've got Chris and John in there, and everybody. There's no other team that is rooting for you more than this one. This one is like, these guys really care about the vibe, and I think that they really value the way that trickles down from the top. And that's not always the case. And, you know, sometimes you'll get a lot of the team that cares, and, you know, but there's something that happens where it doesn't, it's not like it is here. And it is so valuable when it happens that way, because it with them caring about the vibe as much as they do, everybody just kind of locks in this great energy when we're there. It's very positive, and everybody's having a lot of fun, and it's because those guys care about the vibe, you know. And we're gonna have Alan Silvestri back and Bob back in October. They're coming back to visit us. And wow. You know, when I went on for Doc the other day, I was telling Alan that you know, now that I know him, it's like when I hear this iconic soundtrack, which has always been part of, it was like the best parts of my childhood waving to me and keeping me company. But it's like, you're hearing the soundtrack, and now you got a friend rooting for you along the way. It's a cool feeling.
A friend that created it. A friend that made it.
Exactly.
And Merritt went on and was fantastic. And like, the best thing is to have our director, John, you know, waiting in the wings to say congratulations, you know, to be there. It's like, you know, when you were young and your parents came to pick you up from daycare and you were so excited to see them. That's the vibe that we're feeling when these people that care so much about the show, like, they have our back and we're so excited to see them. And they're so excited for us because the show is in such a great shape and the show feels so fun and the audience is having such a great time. It's really something special.
I agree. And every time I go, like the first time I went, and I've been multiple times, right? And the first time I went is, like you said, Merritt, the first downbeat of the overture, when you hear that iconic music that is ingrained in your childhood, just like fill the space in such perfection being played live. That I think back to that moment when I think about the show all the time. It's just, you know, why a lot of people will go see the Philharmonic play Lord of the Rings live, right? Like, to hear that music being played in real time by real people in a space like that, it's, you know, it can't be beat. That's why, like, live theater is part of why live theater is so great in my book.
It's a place to be. Like last night at the stage door, there was this little boy, couldn't have been more than 8. His name was Chase. And he introduced himself as Chase and told me that he wanted to be an actor and he loved the show so much. And is there any way that he could see backstage? And I was like, Chase, come with me.
Let's
and I took
go.
Him, his parents and his family, and I took him backstage, and he was dressed in his like Marty McFly outfit. Like it was perfect. And to me, it's this show is inspiring, you know, the next generation of actors and storytellers and singers to sort of have this experience with their parents and it be so well received. And so I just saw that twinkle in his eye and I was like, no, you need to come on. So he got to take his picture on stage and have that moment.
Wow.
And then on the other side, there's a girl I saw at the stage door. It was her 10th time seeing the show.
Yes. What's her name?
So I said to her,
do you remember?
I think her name is Laura. I think it's Laura. I, Don't quote me, but I took her backstage too. And like, these people are really, they're with us. They're part of our network now. They're part of they're our support, you know? And it's so fun to see these familiar faces and to see the people that really connect with the show that want to see it again and again and again. And we're happy to have them again and again and again.
Wow. Yeah. That's cool. And so Chase, if you're listening, write me and tell me how the car works. Now that you've been backstage, I need to know how that DeLorean gets off the ground. That's all I got to say.
Like you were saying about the soundtrack, you mentioned, you know, some other live scoring events, like when people go see the Lord of the Rings played by the Philharmonic or something like that.
Yeah.
This is the best live scoring event and most unique live scoring event in the world. Because you have everything that you would see at a live, you would hear at a live scoring event, but you have the live story happening right in front of you.
Yes.
And all of the iconic soundtrack has been tailored to the live presentation. And this is the year on Broadway where guys like Alan Silvestri and Josh Groban over at Sweeney Todd, and before we were here with Hugh Jackman and Music Man, I'm so happy that these guys are really they're putting the orchestra at a very, very high place on the list, because we're maxing out Broadway pits and you can really tell the difference.
Yeah.
I mean, you go hear these big pits. We have 18 pieces. An 18-piece pit, the Winter Garden, and it's just like a thunderstorm of iconic soundtrack coming out of there. And I just am so thankful that guys like Alan Silvestri are like, I'm very excited. You can absolutely use my iconic soundtrack, but we're gonna max out that pit. And they do
I
it.
I love that.
Yeah.
We're gonna be right back.
I mean, it's great how, I mean, just a couple notes of one instrument, like, bring all this back, right? I'm just thinking about that trumpet line, you know, it's like that, you hear that no matter where you are.
That was a great trumpet.
Thank really you, good my trumpet. My mouth trumpet's on point.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah, like just these things. God, I'm getting goosebumps thinking about it. Like, this is a show that really takes me back, and I'm gonna come again, Jelani. When I come again, you got to take me backstage now. I promise I won't.
Look. Only if you dress like Marty McFly.
Deal.
Only if you dress up like Marty McFly.
Deal. Yeah,
bring us your best vest.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right. I got a red vest that people make fun of all the time. They ask me if I'm Marty McFly. Okay. Let's see. As we're coming up to the end here, I want to do a little Back to the Future movie trivia with you both. And if either of you know the answer, shout it out. We got five questions that we'll ask. And the first one, it's a little gimme. You should know this. What year was the movie released? This is movie trivia.
1985.
Exactly. Ding, ding. There you go. All right.
Question. Is this a competition?
You want it to be? Okay, it is now.
So Merritt's already on the board? Okay,
Merritt's on the board. All right. What was Marty McFly's...
got nervous.
All right, question two. What was Marty McFly's original last name in one of the earlier versions of the script?
Whoa.
Marty J. Fox.
Marty McDermott.
Really?
McDermott.
I learned something today.
McDermott. Okay.
Is Bob secretly watching this with a joystick like... Son of a bitch. They didn't know it. Damn it!
McDermott, damn it!
Sorry, Bob.
Back to the Future was almost not the name of the movie. What did the producers want it to be called originally?
A Matter of Time.
No, Casey Likes knew this one, by the way. Spaceman from Pluto.
Very different.
There is a memo.
Spaceman from Pluto.
Yeah.
I'm glad they went with Back to the Future.
Me too. Me too. I think it was Bob Gale who was like, no way we're calling it Spaceman from Pluto. I forget. All right. Call. So this is we'll play Price is Right version here. Guess a number without going over. How many times was the Back to the Future script rejected by studios?
You go first, John.
Eight. Is it more? No whammies, no whammies, no whammies, no
Wait,
whammies.
So has he gone over or is he under? Is it this? Yeah, $1, Bob.
Yeah, what's
$1?
44 times. 44 wow. rejections. So there you go, kids. Never give up on your dreams. Okay.
Never give up.
Okay, last question. I'm sure one of you will get this one. In the first act scene in the movie where Marty's band, the Pinheads, is auditioning for the high school battle of the bands contest, who plays the school teacher who cuts the band
Huey
short,
Lewis.
Announcing via the mic? Yes, Huey Lewis. All right. So that's
talked to Huey
nothing,
about that.
Jelani. Did you?
Yeah. He was he was trying to get me to work in that line where he says, "I'm afraid you're just too darn loud."
Yeah,
and he wanted that to be in the beginning. I said, "Well, actually, if you notice, I say it in 1955 when I go up to Marty while he's playing his guitar solo. Strickland
yes.
says,
mm-hmm.
you're
yes.
too darn loud. Turn down that noise."
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You could just say, like, singular, "Hold it, fella. I'm afraid you're just too darn loud."
I like the fella. Hold on there, fella. Yeah.
Hold on there, guy. Fella.
Hold on.
All right.
Hold on there, ace.
All right. Well, Merritt, you've won bragging rights over Jelani. You won
that. I don't think so. I actually, please don't tell anybody that we didn't know any of these questions.
Okay. The recording is now off. I mean, it was never. Okay. Never.
Two out of five ain't bad.
Two out of five ain't bad. That was pretty
two
hard.
Two out
stuff.
Of five ain't bad.
What if I was just, okay.
What if I was just like the biggest ass on like two out of five? Gotcha.
I'm the best. All right. So my three closing questions that I do ask everybody on every single episode to this point, and this is going to be episode 280 something, 290 something. God, I'm getting up to 300 now. Okay. Merritt, we'll start with you. Question number one, just simply, what motivates you?
Excuse me? What motivates me in what?
Yes.
In the show?
In
or
life.
Just overall?
In life, to wake up in the morning and put on a smile.
Wow, this is a big question. What motivates me? Mostly food. You know, Jelani and I will go out. We'll find ourselves a good steakhouse.
Yeah,
that's true. We do like to treat ourselves, and have nice dinners, and it's sort of to decompress, to chat, to catch up. It's pretty. I look forward to it.
Yeah, we should do some kind of steakhouse of the week. We should write in all the steakhouses we've been to or of the month.
I like that.
You could call it a little segment.
Which ones we went to and be like, "This was the best one. Here's why."
Yeah. Call it the Raising the Stakes Power Hour.
Yeah. As a result, they should all give us Raising the Stakes.
Yeah.
And as a result, they should all give us free steak.
Yep.
Yeah.
How about
that?
They
give them free publicity, they give you free steaks. There you go.
That's right.
Jelani, I know you've answered this in the other episode, but you're welcome to change your answer, or if you don't remember, come up again. But what motivates you?
I don't know if I remember, but what motivates me is seeing my colleagues, like seeing people shine, like seeing my fellow actor friends and choreographer friends, what they're doing in the world and what they're putting out there. That motivates me for sure.
All right. So Jelani, now we'll start with you this time. What advice would you give to your younger self and younger people listening now, starting out down a similar path?
I would tell them that you are enough and don't try and be a mold of something you've seen before. Know that, like, what makes you weird and unique is what's going to keep you, you know, keep you shining. And don't try to put yourself in a box. You are enough.
Nice. Merritt, what's your advice?
And you got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
Hey. Boom. Boy, these are really good answers. Jelani's winning on these answers for sure. But I was like,
there's no
food.
Winning. It's just a
food.
Eat more food.
It's like, live your dreams. I'm like, nice. What would I say to my younger self? Well, I would say to my younger self and to a lot of younger people, there's lots of reasons not to do things. And a lot of people kind of miss out on things because there's lots of reasons not to do things. And the reason that I've gotten to be on this great adventure that I'm on is because I found one reason to show up. And, you know, I think back to that first audition with Wedding Singer. There was plenty of reasons for me not to be there. It was like right in the middle of school. And I decided I should start to practice auditioning before I leave school. And it led to my first tour. And that has led me here. And there's a lot of people that love you that'll give you a lot of reasons not to do things, you know. People's tendency is to start thinking, oh, well, it just won't work out for reasons A through Z. And the reasons not to do things occur to a lot of people. And a lot of times it prevents them from doing what they really want to do. And all you got to do is find one reason to show up. And a lot of great things can happen. So there's lots of reasons not to do things and find one reason to show up.
Have you seen that montage of Lady Gaga saying there could be a room of 99 people saying no, but all you need is one?
There you go.
Do you know that all you need is one?
Yep.
All you need is one. Yeah,
you're right. You're right.
That's right.
Thank you. Thank you, Lady
Thanks,
Gaga.
Thanks, Gags.
All right. Thanks, the Gags.
Giga.
All right, Merritt, last question. If you can only see one show for the rest of your life, but you can see it as many times as you want, what would you see?
See one show for the rest of my life. Disaster the Musical. No. Back to the Future the Musical. And cheers to Shameless Promotion.
Good answer.
Jelani, do you have an answer?
I think that's the truth, actually. I think that's the truth. I would see this show. I could watch this show. If I could only watch one, I could watch this one.
That's a good one. Jelani, yeah.
You know, my go-to show is The Lion King. I just, anytime I have a night or needed like a boost or inspiration or just to go home, quote unquote, I go see the show and I just love it so much.
I love that. Well, where can we find you both on social media? Merritt, where do you play that game?
I'm MDJ Tanner on Instagram and my name on
DJ Tanner. I get it. On Facebook. Reference.
Love it.
Yeah. Because right. DJ was the responsible one.
That's right.
You can catch me at It's Jelani Remy on Instagram.
Thank you both so much. Appreciate you. And
thank you, buddy.
And everybody.
Thank you for having us.
See Back to the Future. So good.